Okay, final topic is fracking. Fracking is an issue in Fermanagh that needs no introduction. And it would appear that all of you on the panel tonight are against fracking. My question to each of you is, if you are so against this process, how do you propose to meet the energy needs of tomorrow's generation? We'll start with John Coyle.
Well,
if you say no to fracking, what's the alternative? What do you do?
Well, we have, there's a lot of controversial things like wind farms as well that, a lot of people don't want, especially in Fermanagh, like that the outstanding beauty. We have a great coastal, north coast of Antrim and Derry that maybe tidal wave could be enhanced. The Carlingford Loch could be beneficial to providing wave energy to be sold back into the grid.
What about in Fermanagh?
Oh, in Fermanagh. It's.
But you're against fracking, aren't you? And
yes, we are totally opposed to fracking.
The SDLP would have us believe that they stopped fracking in Fermanagh. Is that your view?
Our minister, Mark Hitch Durkin, took the decision to provoke the licence for exploration. So with him and Arlene Foster, then came together and made sure that it was stopped until an assessment was done to the environmental impacts that it was caused.
So Arlene Foster and Mark Hitch Durkin stopped fracking in Fermanagh?
For they came together and provided, they had to get a reassurance.
Okay.
But then our three MPs in Westminster welcomed a moratorium on fracking, so they are actively over there to stop fracking coming into the UK and especially Northern Ireland.
Okay, Tom Elliott, if there's no fracking, what's the solution? What do you do?
Well, I think it's a very good question, Rodney, in the sense that we have to find an energy source. Now, if you look at the ordinary household, you can make households much more energy efficient and save the energy there. But when you get down to business and providing energy for business, it is much more difficult. I see huge opportunities, not only in tidal wave, but actually wind farms on the sea, because they provide a huge opportunity. It's not that often that you don't have wind and you're out in the sea. So they provide a good opportunity and they provide much better energy production than the wind farms on your local mountain. They obviously feed back into the grid and would supply all of Northern Ireland. We also have more renewable sources coming forward, like the solar panels, which provide on a lower base, but they are still quite useful. And I think we need to look at much more of those renewable energy sources, because fossil fuels are still there, but how long they will be there for, I don't know.
Well, your party took an extremely woolly stance on this issue in advance of the last election. So where exactly do you and your colleagues stand on this?
On what?
On fracking.
On fracking, we have always said that the process that was being proposed for Fermanagh, we were extremely concerned about it and certainly could not support it for a number of reasons. One reason was they were proposing a shallow type frack compared to most of the fracking that goes on in areas in America. That hadn't been tried in a large degree anywhere else, so it was broadly unconvincing. Second issue was they indicated that they were going to try to do this fracking without using any chemicals. I don't know anywhere else in the world that they have found it possible to carry out that fracking without the chemicals. So I don't think it was probably feasible what they were proposing. So I just think it was a non-workable process from the start.
Tanya Jones, how do you propose to meet the energy needs of tomorrow's generation?
It can be done. It can be done relatively easily. There are studies all around the world which have looked at renewable energy and energy efficiency combined, and we are there. Some people talk about fracking as being necessary as a transition fuel between now and sometime in the future when we can use renewable energy. But the truth is, there is no need for that. We have all that we need here. We have it particularly richly on the island of Ireland. We have, as people have mentioned, wave, tidal, onshore and offshore wind. We not only have the resources to meet all of our own energy needs, but we have sufficient to export. We have the right capabilities, the right engineering tradition, the right universities in order to develop a real renewable energy industry, which would provide real jobs and real exports. So really, renewable energy is an absolute gold mine, a real gold mine for Northern Ireland, and we ought to be embracing that, and we ought to be world leaders at it.
Yeah. Michelle Guinness, your colleague Sinn Féin MEP Martine Anderson spoke at your anti-fracking conference. Mm-hmm. She said at one point that Sinn Féin wouldn't be able to intervene in the issuing of petroleum licences because it would have an impact on the fragile peace process. Are you politicising one of the most important issues to face Fermanagh?
Not at all. I think Martina was reacting to a question whereby people had unrealistic expectations of what the executive could actually deliver. I think that we had a fabulous conference a couple of weeks ago, packed room, very, very dedicated, brilliant speakers, people like Professor Tony Ingraffia from Cornell University, who wrote the book on fracking. But local people, John Sheridan, Carol O'Dolan, Brenna O'Rourke, brilliant conference. And it highlighted just how fragile the ecosystem in Fermanagh is, and how it was a complete, it was ridiculous to even contemplate fracking this beautiful part of Ireland, and the implications it would have, not just for Fermanagh people, but for beyond. You asked how would we meet our energy needs. A lot of people have said things that I was going to say. I also want to add biomass to that tidal, wind and wave energy, and look at how we can develop that. If we were to put the same subsidies into developing renewable energy as has been done across the world in fracking, I don't think we'd be contemplating doing something so dangerous and so detrimental to our agriculture, to our air quality, our water quality, and our tourism industry here. I also believe that if fracking goes ahead, it'll destroy Fermanagh completely. And we have to find alternative ways of providing energy. I think that it can be done. I think those subsidies could be used much more wisely. And I think that fracking to release what is still a fossil fuel and is still finite is just a waste of time and money. And we did welcome Mark Durkin's intervention as Environment Minister, but I don't agree with John's point on Arlene Foster, because I think if Arlene had her way and the DUP had their way, they would have introduced fracking. In fact, one of the first executive meetings I was at in 2007, the DUP were advocating nuclear energy for the north of Ireland, so that sort of says it all.
Okay, any questions? Sorry, tweets
yeah.
First.
No, I actually have a question myself. So my name's Anne Robert, and I'm not representing Rockwell Owen Asset. But I mean, just to kind of come back, we looked at health, we looked at education, and we've looked at the importance of the cuts that have taken place within those different departments. Now we're looking at energy and renewable energy. And to me, the overall feeling tonight is that we need to start looking at change, and the cuts aren't acceptable. So my question is, with cuts to the education system, with cuts to the health service, and with cuts to other departments as well, how can we invest in renewable energy sources, and how can we invest in those other things as well? Surely that is the key. I just want to just quickly say, two economics Nobel laureates, Paul Krugman and Joseph Stiglitz, won their Nobel Prize because they proved the myth that is austerity, that it doesn't work. So what is the alternative, and how can we stand up to the Conservative government, and how can we invest in renewable energy sources?
John Coyle, do you want to take that?
The DETI works closely with the regulator to promote renewable energy. It needs to be more forthright. You know, political intervention needs to be there for to tell like NI power and you know, these big companies, that they have to be focused on renewable energy and providing it out to the local people. It's they'll be rewarded with the benefits if the renewable energy is sold back to the grid.
Okay, Tanya and then Michelle, very quickly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. A lot of these funding questions are as the question suggested, red herrings. The situation is that the UK is a sovereign nation with its own currency. Mm-hmm. It therefore has the power to create the money that it needs. At the moment, most of that power is given over to banks. At the moment, 97% of all money created is created by banks, but that is a decision of the government and it doesn't have to be like that. We saw from quantitative easing that the government is quite capable of creating money when it wants to. Of that $375 billion that was created by quantitative easing, only 8% went into the real economy. All the rest of it went to make already rich people richer. If it can be done for such a destructive, useless reason as that, then we can easily create the money that we need in order to invest in essential things like renewable energy, like health, like education, like sustainable businesses. So really, it's a red herring. If the government wanted to invest, they could do.
Okay, Michelle, very quickly.
Well, you could add the petroleum companies to that as well, and if you look at what Shell have done in their human rights record in parts of Africa, in the desire to get cheap energy, there's a lot of people should have hang their heads in shame. When you start a question, Robert, with a disclaimer, you know it's going to be an interesting one. But I'll tell you how we invest in it. We invest in our youth, and South West College have to be commended for the programmes and the courses that they have developed to bring young people from this area in to use their talents, their skills and their abilities to create new forms of renewable energy and to find ways of tapping into renewable energy. And that investment is being done here, and I commend South West College for their vision in doing that.
Thank you. Barry has a question and then we're running out of time.
No, Robbie, I think everything was dealt with in the class.
You're okay? Yeah. Any other questions? Yep.
Richard Allison, going back to the health issue, I didn't want to stand up and speak twice. Bevin would be turning in his grave if he saw how the NHS was being treated by this government. That's the first thing. Now, renewable energy comes in many different forms. Gas is obviously the one that is on everybody's mind when we talk about fracking. We have a grid, electricity grid, to every home, apart from mine, every home in the country. If energy prices could come down, everybody benefits. Okay? If you can create energy offshore, tidal, wherever, we don't actually have to generate it in Fermanagh. You know, what Rodney was saying, you know, what are we going to do? Well, we can do a lot of different industries, not necessarily in our own renewable energy, because we're grid integrated. But there is one form of renewable energy which I believe in Five Mile Town was proposed and the community put a stop to it. And that is what comes out the back of thousands and thousands and thousands of animals in Fermanagh, and that can provide both gas and electricity within Fermanagh. You can't make an omelette without breaking a few eggs.
All right, do you want to ask the two farmers?
biogas. Okay, what are your views on biogas?
Two farmers first, Tom Elliott and then John.
Okay, I do recall that project, Richard, and I remember attending the public meeting in Five Mile Town that night, which I think I was probably the only public representative that gave it any sort of airtime. And simply because it was being built close to the town was the main objection. Problem was, to utilise it to its full effect, it had to be close to centre of population to use the heating system that could come from it.
Yeah.
They then had another plan to build it, I think it was about 3 or 4 miles out in the country. Yeah, it wouldn't have been able to use that heating system, but it was still going to work economically. As a farmer, I support that process. I believe it's safe. You also have a byproduct that is a low-level fertilizer. So by and large, I support it. Depending that it's done properly and that it is done legally and that it meets the tests. I have been at a couple of plants. There was one set up at OMA that Fermanagh Council, I don't think Brendan was on at the time either, but we visited one at OMA a few years ago and it was working quite well.
Okay, John Coyle.
Yeah, I think it's a good idea. With the high level of rainfall in Fermanagh, you know, it'd be perfect. It takes out the wet out of the manure. So then you have a dry product that you can put out onto your fields, which has the benefit of the same as slurry. So we have two benefits in the one. So it's a good idea. Once it's legally and, is protected, that the public is protected at every level and at every stage.
Okay, and very briefly, Michelle and Tanya. Michelle, you're former agriculture minister. Do you agree with this idea?
Absolutely. But I suppose we need to be cognizant of the fact that there was a scheme proposed in Glenavy, right on the shores of Loch Ness, where they were going to bring chicken litter from far and wide to fulfil a need in a population in Belfast. So we have to get the balance right. I also met a man who was involved in an enterprise, I think in Limerick or Tipperary, where they were doing the same thing but on a small scale for their own energy needs, and they were able, there wasn't huge transportation costs, they weren't bringing it from all over, they were able to use the chicken litter on farm to create energy. So we need to be creative. There are small models. I mean, we are way decades behind Germany and other European countries on this. We can do so much more. We don't have to pollute Loch Ness in the process, but we can find a way. It's only a waste product until you find something to do with it, and then it's a resource.
Tanya, finally.
Yeah, I think that what this indicates is that we not only have to change the source of power that we receive, but we have to change the way that we organise the structures as well. It's not enough to have huge corporations with huge projects which are imposed on local people. That's not right and it's not necessary. It's not the most efficient way of using renewable energy. As Michelle mentioned, in Germany there are countless community schemes where people have a cooperative, their own community find the best power sources, and the benefits are shared by the community, and in that case it's what the community want. It's sustainable, and it's the way forward.
Yeah. Okay, and just one final question for everybody, and summing everything up, in just a few words, why should all these people vote for you in the elections? That's what this is all about. John Coyle, in just a few words, why should these people vote for you?
Well, I'm a young politician. Hopefully that I have fresh ideas coming into it. I will represent everybody to the best of my ability, and bring economic prosperity to Fermanagh South Tyrone.
Tom Elliott.
Okay, I'm someone who wants to represent everyone. I'm a leveller on the ground. I'm not, as many people would say, a professional politician. I like being among the people, and that's where I think the power is, and that's where I think it should be, is among the people.
Tanya Jones.
Yeah, this is the first opportunity that people have had to vote Green in a Westminster election, and I'm aware a lot of people don't actually know that much about the Green Party. We have four key principles, which are non-violence, social justice, environmental sustainability, and grassroots democracy. And all those work together, and they inform everything that we say and everything that we do. And this is your opportunity to look to the future beyond sectarianism and look at the global force, which is the Green Parties.
I'm Michelle Galvin.
Well, I think the people of Fermanagh have rejected sectarianism, because when I was elected the last time, it was Catholic, Protestant and dissenter, people of all faiths and none, and I'm very privileged and honoured, yes, which then was reduced to one after an electoral count, but it's still a majority. So I believe that I can continue to work to represent everybody. I won't try to do that. I'm already doing it. I have done it for a period of time. I believe passionately in this constituency, in the people of this constituency, and ensuring that they get the services that they need and they deserve. So
you'll take your seat when you get elected, will you?
I didn't say that, did I, Rodney? I'm trying to put words in my mouth. I also do want to say that I've just asked Sean Lynch's third missed call. I'm supposed to be chairing a meeting in Lisniski. And I don't want to be rude and run out at the end of this. I would have liked to have got a chance to talk, especially to Dara and Matthew. But unfortunately, I can't be in two places at the one time. But there'll be no, don't be, you'll not be getting a headline out of me tonight, Rodney.
Okay, and that concludes our debate. Thank you very much.